we have a few minutes to talk, and I think I want to start with, how does it feel to be back in Alberta, Delwin?
Oh, it's always fun to be back in Alberta. It's always great. Not in the winter so much. I don't like the winter so much, but then again, I don't like winters in Paris, so that's okay. No, it's good to be back in Alberta, especially after having been gone for a few years.
Does it feel different?
It feels good. You know, I'm never around in Alberta long enough to know how different it feels actually to live here. You know, from talking to friends and so on, I think there are differences. I think it does feel different for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. Does it feel like home still?
Does it feel like home? Nowhere quite feels like home. You know, I go to my parents' place in Edmonton, and that feels somewhat home. But I'm not sure that Alberta feels home any more than Paris feels home. Yeah. It's another place that I'd like to visit.
Can you believe that it has been 15 years since the Supreme Court ruling? And more than 20 years since this whole saga began for you.
Yeah.
20 years.
Yeah, more than 20 years. 22 years. 23 years, probably. Time flies.
It does. Well, let's go back to that
just
day.
Get older.
I mean, I think people, we all want to know what it was like back then. I mean, take us back to the early 90s when you were asked to resign from your job as a lab instructor at King's College in Edmonton. I mean, what happened on that day?
That day, that was a Monday morning. It was a week after my birthday. And on a Monday morning, I walked into the college, and the first thing I got was the head of the department said, the president wants to see us. Like, okay. And I knew it was coming. It was in the air already. Walk into the president's office, and he shows me a letter. And he says, I'd like you to sign this. And it's a letter of resignation, actually, pre-written for me. And he says, if you don't sign it, I asked him, so what if I don't sign it? It's like, well, then your employment is terminated as of noon today. So I said, well, I'm not signing it. And this was about 8:30 in the morning. The head of the department and I went up to our offices and we talked a little bit about it and decided, do you think there's a bar open? And we went out for a beer. We found a bar, had a beer, returned to the college at noon, and I packed up my stuff from my office and left. With several students coming into my office to ask questions, and I basically had to say, look, I'm sorry, I can't help you. I don't work here anymore.
Why did you not sign it?
Why sign it? It seemed a little bit ridiculous that they would even ask me to sign a resignation letter. You know, what does that do for me? Either way, I'm going to be out of a job. Signing a resignation letter, that helps them. But it does nothing for me. So ultimately, I mean, there's no big secret there. It's just that it would be silly for me to sign it. I'm not signing it. That said, I had been in contact with a lawyer beforehand. We knew that this was coming for over a year. We knew that they were thinking about this whole issue and wondering what they were going to do about it. So I had been in contact with a lawyer. And I was also a member, in fact, at that time I was president of the Gay and Lesbian Awareness, the association in Edmonton, which was a human rights legislation for gay and lesbian rights in Alberta. And we had all discussed that as well, and what do you do as well? I had seen a lawyer, I had taken notes over the year as to what was going on.
And you had spoken to your instructor before and disclosed.
Oh yeah, yeah. Oh, that was when I was first hired. Yeah, when I was first, not first hired, because I was hired initially on a temporary basis for 4 months, and then that went so well they decided to hire me on a permanent basis. And when they decided to hire me on a permanent basis, that's when I told the head of the department, my boss, that I would love the job. But, I think there might be something here that the university could have a problem with at some point. That's, I'm gay. And he said, well, Delwin, that's not something that I think should be a problem. I hope it doesn't become a problem here. I think we should just proceed as if it's not a problem.
And you were receiving very positive reports.
It was going extremely well. Students loved loved my teaching. They did well. I was always receiving a lot of commendations about it. There was never an issue with my work.
So the fact that you had support in the LGBT community was great, but at the same time, you grew up in a very religious family.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You yourself, very religious person in the Christian Reformed Church. I mean, how did you explain this to your family and to your parents? Did they know that something was going to be coming? Perhaps it was going to be difficult for you at work?
They knew as much as I did. I kept them informed the whole time. Yeah, my parents, as soon as a year before I was fired, the president of the college had called me into his office as well to verify something that he had been told, and that he had been told that I was gay, and he wanted to verify this before he proceeded with anything else. So right from that point, I mean, I told my parents, well, this is what happened. We'll see what happens in the next few months.
What was that like for you, having that discussion, that very personal discussion about your sexuality with your parents because of your work?
Oh, well, I mean, it wasn't that personal a conversation about my sexuality. It's not like we were talking about what I did in bed with my boyfriend. it was stuff that we already talked about. So that was not a big deal. I had come out to my parents already before I started working at the King's College. So that was not a big deal.
So, Delwin, what happened to get the ball rolling on your case? What did you do?
What did I do?
How did it get to the Human Rights Commission?
Well, the very first thing was an appeal with the board of the college. I had a lawyer at the time, the very first thing was I talked to my lawyer. So what do I do? Well, we already had the employee handbook from the university and whatever, and he sees, yes, there's an appeals procedure. So we have to go through that appeals procedure. So I go through that with the university, with the college, and they don't even see it, actually. It doesn't even go to the board. The president just denies it. It's like, no, this is not going anywhere. Like, okay, well, that's the end of that. The next step in the procedure was to go to the Human Rights Commission, and made an appointment with the Human Rights Commission, and I went in and shook hands with the receptionist and with a few of the lawyers, and they were all very pleasant. They were like, "Oh, this is Delwin Vriend." Like, they had already heard of me, and I was thinking, "Oh, good, maybe this is going to go well." it was obvious they wanted it to go well, but they had been instructed by the province of Alberta under Ralph Klein that they were not to hear any cases related to sexual orientation. So their hands were basically tied, and they said, we can't do anything about this. This is sexual orientation, and that's the end. I kept trying to twist it a little bit. It's like, well, maybe it's not sexual orientation. Maybe it's gender, because they wouldn't fire me if I was a woman and was attracted to men, right? It's like.
So it's how, like, long did that take? I mean, when you went and met the folks at the Alberta Human Rights Commission, from how long did that take to find out that your case would not be heard there?
By the Human Rights Commission?
Yes.
I was basically told right away.
And then what happened after that?
So after that, I'm not sure if I got that in writing right away or if we asked for it in writing. We had to have something in writing, obviously. After that, it was a process where my lawyer had to get together his case to be heard in front of the Court of Queen's Bench. And that's what we did.
And meanwhile, you're not working, I assume, or were you?
I was not working for several months. Yeah, you're right. I was not working for four or five, maybe 4 months, maybe 5 months.
And yet you have this case, and as our panelists pointed out, it was taken on pro bono, I guess.
Well, at this point, it was not taken on pro bono. At this point, this was with my first lawyer, Victor, I always forget his last name. He was not doing this pro bono, and we had to do a lot of, I paid out the first, I'm not sure how much, but for my consultations with him, and then we did a lot of fundraising in order to raise the funds for the court case, and that was actually fairly expensive, even after the court case had been heard and his time had basically been used. We still had a lot to fundraise for. So,
and just go through it very quickly. I think you won the first one, and then you lost the second, and then then it went to the Supreme Court. So what was the time frame there? I mean, how long did it take all of those cases together?
Well, yeah, I mean, all the cases right to the, from the start to the final decision, the Supreme Court decision, took 7 years. So you can sort of see that there were a couple of years between each court case where you're waiting for a hearing date to be set, and then your lawyers are putting together the case. So there's a lot of time between the hearings. So there were, like you said, the three cases, the Court of Queen's Bench, the Court of Appeal, and the Supreme Court of Canada.
And who was helping you all the way along? I mean, were you gathering new people along the way, or how did you manage to keep this up?
Well, it wasn't the public, so there were a lot of people that would especially come out for rallies and so on, that in support of this and against what the government was refusing to do on its own. Once the first court case was finished, my lawyer actually at the time moved to Ottawa, and we got Sheila Greco as the lawyer, and she went pro bono. So our costs were minimized because of that. She and Doug basically donating their own services. There are still legal costs, though. There are the costs of the filing costs, and there's all sorts of odds and ends. And I think in the end, it was about $75,000 worth of other costs, $50,000 of which we did manage to fundraise. And I think we are still outstanding $25,000. Mm-hmm. Doug's family probably paid for a lot of that. But so there was, in terms of the people who were getting involved, there were still a lot of people who were donating money as well. The lawyers were very involved in this, and then it was really in the media. It was the media. It was the rallies, and perhaps even going to the Minister of Human Rights. I don't know if it was called the Minister of Human Rights, but
responsible for that.
Sorry,
I think it was under the Community Spirit Ministry at one point.
Yeah, something strange.
Yeah. But did you ever feel like giving up along the way?
Yeah, I did. So one thing about the case is that I wasn't extremely involved in the case itself. When you think of a legal case, you often think of the person that's involved being up on the stand and giving testimony and being cross-examined and so on. None of that happened. Okay? I was not involved in preparing the cases. I was not involved in arguing the cases. I didn't even have to be in the courtrooms. I did go to the courtrooms just to see, because it was interesting and I wanted to see what was happening. And of course, media expected me to be there too. So, but I wasn't involved in the legal end. So did I want to just say forget it? In terms of the legal end, there was nothing for me to forget about. What there was for me was the media. And I ended up being basically the media the media face for the case.
You were the poster child for this case.
I always hated that, yeah, that phrase, that poster boy or poster child. It's like, didn't like that. It was difficult. It's not me. I'm not someone who loves being in the public light. It was very stressful. I would often not answer my phone. My phone would ring off the hook some days, especially if something came up, something about sexual orientation. I would have hundreds of phone calls, and I would crawl into my bed and crawl up into a ball and just wish that phone would stop ringing. So there were definitely times when I wanted to give up and say, no more of this. I was asked many times, actually at the end of each case, one of my protectors, especially my media protector, Murray Billett, he was always around. He was very involved in the case. And he was someone who always like, no, Delwin's had enough, stay away. And he, at the end of each case, also came to me and said, do you want to go on? It's like, you've got a choice. And I did say yes, even though in some ways I did want to go on. I wanted this case to go on, and I thought it was important that there be a media face to this. In many ways, we won the case much even more in the media than we did in the court case, in the courts. So I thought it was important. But I did think, oh, maybe it would be nice. Except that I also knew the court case would go on whether I was involved or not.
What was the personal toll? I mean, you allude to the fact you wanted to just sort of make it go away for a while, but what was the personal toll? I mean, obviously it was financial, it was personal.
Well, for me, there wasn't a whole lot of financial toll. There was, you know, initially I did pay out some legal costs myself, but we did a lot of fundraising, and there wasn't a big financial toll. I think one of the tolls was a social toll. It was probably one of the reasons, in fact it was, there's no doubt about it, one of the reasons that I left Edmonton, that I left Alberta, that I left Canada. And that is that so many people, because of my presence in the media, so many people thought they knew me, where they only knew this image that the media painted of me, and that we were painting of me. I mean, this was the boy next door. He got fired. He's this perfect, you know, perfect person. And I would meet so many people, and I wouldn't know them, but they would, oh, hi, Delwin. I was like, oh, you know, they were very happy to meet me, but they also knew me somehow. And I really didn't. I needed to get out of that. It's like, no, you don't even know me. It was like I could no longer meet people on an honest basis. There was a superficial basis to all the meetings. And,
were you ever afraid? I mean, were there threats against you?
I did have a couple of letters come to me. One was a bomb threat. It wasn't a death threat per se, but a bomb threat. But I didn't take it seriously. I mean, and that was fairly early on in the case. That wasn't something that worried me much, and still wouldn't.
Obviously, your parents supported you, but when you think about the toll on them as well, how do you think they've managed throughout all of this? I mean, you come from an interesting family. Yeah. They're vegan, organic farmers, is that correct? But deeply religious at the same, not but, and deeply religious.
And less so now.
Yeah, I just wonder, how have they fared through all of this?
Well, they have definitely lost their share of friends as well over this. But they're strong people, especially my mom, very strong person, very strong woman. They've definitely lost friends that, you know, they might talk to a little bit now and then, now, you know, 23 years later, but it's not, these were close friends, and and it wasn't so much over the fact that I was gay, but over the fact that I was taking, and I wasn't even taking the college to court, but that was the thought, I was taking the college to court.
Mm-hmm. And it was the Christian Reform
yes,
College,
yeah.
Private college. Would you do it again? Faced with the same circumstances,
I would do it again.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's little doubt there. When it comes to injustice, I can't stand by and do nothing. And I mean, I hope it sort of sounds self-serving when I say it that way. Because it was unjust towards me, so yeah, of course I'm going to take it on. But
it's a principle
there, and it's just not right.
Well, I want to fast forward to the situation that came up today, especially the one that Dan focused on, and in the past couple of years, as you know, and I know mm-hmm. that you probably have not been following Alberta politics from Paris,
a
but.
Little.
You may be aware then that, as Dan pointed out, that the Alberta Human Rights Act has been in the news, and parents can, under the law, let their kids opt out of learning about sexuality, religion, and sexual orientation. What do you think about that? I mean, tell me your thoughts about the implications of that, and are there some?
Well, I think Dan even pointed one out. There's sort of it's like a freeze. There's a gel on gel. That's French.
A chill.
There we go. on expression within schools. It's like we can't do this because we'd have to. You know, there's so much planning in advance you'd have to do, I think that is quite horrible. On the other hand, just in Edmonton, we had a similar forum, and one of the people in the audience was a principal, and he had mentioned too that they had the Gideons wanted to come into the school to give Bibles, and they basically used this to prevent the Gideons from coming in. It's like, no, this is not acceptable. I think it can be used in both ways, and perhaps if we get enough use in the opposite direction than was expected to be used, perhaps we can get rid of it. That would be an interesting twist.
Understands that, and I certainly know the Premier does.